Let me start by thanking the organizers. It's a real pleasure to be part of this online event. Today I'm going to talk about switchable supramolecular trajectories in mechanosynthesis of a halogen-bonded Borromean network. It is about the journey and not the destination. Let's start with the definition of Borromean rings. We have Borromean rings whenever we have three entangled rings where no two rings are interlinked. So by cutting any one of them, the whole structure is falling apart. This topology, higher topology, is known since ancient times, and it was chosen by the Borromean family as their crest. Why Borromean rings are interesting in chemistry? There are several reasons. First of all, their intrinsic complexity and beauty and their challenging preparation are attracting the chemical community. But there is also a practical reason. Higher topology, they may possess novel and unexplored properties, functions, and phenomena. There are several elegant examples of preparation of Borromean rings at molecular scale based on different strategies. Covalent chemistry, dynamic covalent chemistry, supramolecular chemistry, coordination chemistry. Our group have reported in Milan, have reported the formation of Borromean rings starting from an organic cryptand, a family, a series of inorganic salts, and a series of alpha omega diiodo perfluoro alkanes with different lengths. If you mix them in 1:1:1.5 molar ratio in simple ethanol, by slow evaporation, you can obtain novel crystalline forms, where generally the cation is encrypted in the cryptand, and the halides are forming anionic frameworks through halogen bonding with the diiodo perfluoro alkanes. The anionic frameworks, in most of the cases, they possess a Borromean rings network, but they can also possess other topologies, for example, non-interpenetrated topologies. So our initial idea was pretty simple. We take the most studied system, that is the cryptand 222 with potassium iodide and 1,8 diiodo perfluoro octane in 1:1:1.5 molar ratio, and we try to explore if there is the possibility to obtain novel topologies, given that this system is known to form only Borromean rings networks. So we wanted to perform a polymorph screening. We've started in solution, and we discovered that by simple switching from ethanol to methanol, it's possible to obtain these nice needle-like crystals. And this is surprising because Borromean rings networks based on halogen bond are known to form hexagonal crystals. We solved the structure of these needle-like crystals, and we were able to discover a new polymorph based on non-interpenetrated network. Here you see the anionic frameworks, they're forming these rectangular supramolecular structures that are layering but not interpenetrating. From single crystal data, we were able to simulate the morphologies, further confirming that the non-interpenetrated polymorph has a completely different morphology compared to the Borromean rings networks. So once discovered this new polymorph, we wanted to understand the relative stability of the two polymorphs. And we discovered by thermal analysis that if you heat the non-interpenetrated polymorph, you can obtain the Borromean rings networks passing through a monotropic transition, as confirmed by differential scanning calorimetry and polarized optical microscopy coupled with the heat stage. The successful formation of the Borromean rings by heating the non-interpenetrated network was confirmed also by X-ray powder diffraction and DFT calculations that show a relative stability of the two polymorphs and a difference in energy of about 8 kilojoule per mole, where the Borromean rings is the thermodynamic stable form. We then decided to see if it's possible to obtain these Borromean rings through mechanochemistry. To do so, we mixed in a steel jar the three starting components and we performed ball milling experiments at 30 Hz with 2 7-millimeter steel balls. And after 45 minutes, we were surprised to obtain the non-interpenetrated form. The successful formation of polymorph 2 was confirmed by, again, X-ray powder diffraction, thermal analysis, and IR spectroscopy. That turns out to be a very powerful and quick method to ascertain the formation of the two polymorphs. Here, for example, we have the non-interpenetrated polymorph obtained from ball milling from solution and their matching IR spectra. To understand what's happening during the formation of the non-interpenetrated polymorph, we decided to perform real-time in-situ monitoring of the ball milling through powder X-ray diffraction by taking advantage of synchrotron radiation. These experiments were done in collaboration with Tomislav Fricic. The results are striking because at the very beginning of the milling, we are forming the B-component co-crystal between the cryptand, the organic cryptand 222, and the diiodo perfluoro-octane. These crystals are based upon the formation of the iodine-nitrogen-halogen bond, and they were previously unknown. It's very interesting that together with this co-crystal, we are forming also a second intermediate. It's forming after 10 minutes of milling, but unfortunately, we were not able to isolate it. Here is labeled with these blue arrows. By selecting specific peaks of the diffractogram of the different crystalline forms, we were able to follow the kinetics of the mechanosynthesis. And as is clear from this diagram, at the very beginning, again, we have the formation of the B-component co-crystal. And after 45 minutes, we have the decrease of the B-component co-crystal and the formation, the start of the formation of the non-interpenetrated polymorph. Why the CIN halogen bond is prevailing over other interactions and self-assembly driving force at the beginning of the process? This is due to kinetic reasons. Ball milling develops mild frictional heat. And both the cryptand, the organic cryptand, and the diiodo perfluoroctane are low melting solids, so with high mechanochemical reactivity. That is why at the very beginning of the mechanochemical process, they react together to form the B-component co-crystal, while Ki is an ionic solid with high melting point and hence low mechanochemical reactivity. We then try to introduce minor changes in the milling conditions. Specifically, we switched from 2 7 millimeter steel ball to 1 9 millimeter steel ball, and we try to do the ball milling again with the same starting components. And the results is striking because minor changes in the milling conditions have a huge change in the supramolecular trajectory of the process. Indeed, by using 1 9 millimeter steel ball after 25 minutes at 30 Hz, we were able to obtain the Borromean rings network, the polymorph 1. This was confirmed by X-ray powder diffraction again, thermal analysis, and IR spectroscopy. So this a minor change in the overall weight of the milling media has a drastic change in the mechanochemical process. Again, the IR spectroscopy is striking in confirming the formation of the Borromean ring network. So real-time in-situ monitoring is trying to elucidating what's happening, why we have this huge difference in between the two mechanochemical processes. Again, at the very beginning, with 1 9 millimeter steel ball, we have the formation of the B-component system, followed by the immediate formation of the Borromean ring. This means that this time we do not have real intermediates of the process, but we have the concomitant formation of the B-component co-crystal that has high reactivity, but also the starts of the formation of the Borromean rings network, as is clear from in this diagram. We made some hypotheses. The harsher conditions, so the higher weight of the milling media, might produce a thermal effect that hampers the formation of the kinetic form too. The harsher conditions may also assist in lowering the activation energy barrier for the formation of the Borromean rings network. That is why we see the immediate formation of the Borromean rings in by using one single 9 millimeter steel ball. In conclusion, we have demonstrated that for the first time it is possible to obtain Borromea Rings networks through ball milling. Minor changes in the mechanosynthesis conditions can effectively switch the supramolecular trajectory of the process, and this lead to the selective formation of the multi-component polymorphs with different topologies. The work shows the potential of mechanochemistry to obtain complex molecular topologies and to target specific crystalline forms through a sustainable, inexpensive, and facile process. I want to thank you all the collaborators that made this incredible work possible, and I want to thank you all of you for your attention.